Hi, I'm Dr. Gary Namie of the Workplace Bullying Institute. And welcome to this webinar on making the business case. Now, making the business case is an essential part. In fact, it's step three of our three-step plan to enable bullied targets to fight back. But before we can even lay out the three steps in the plan, what I really want to do is give you the rationale for the plan and therefore making the business case. One of the most interesting criticisms I've ever read about our approach is that it's utopic, U-T-O-P-I-C, which sent me immediately to the dictionary, and I learned a new word that week, utopic as in utopian and idealistic. But obviously the person didn't bother reading the entire page at our website that describes the rationale for what I'm about to describe to you. You see, traditional advisors tell bully targets that somehow they have to solve the problem themselves, that they're actually personally responsible for taking action, and therefore it's irrational and irresponsible if they do not take action to alleviate their distress. Now, on one hand, that sounds good, but actually what it does is make the victim responsible for her or his fate. Now, no one has invited this misery upon themselves, and so why are we asking them to extricate themselves from this situation? It's very, very difficult. In fact, it's impossible. So let's get it straight. Our research has shown, and you can go to our website at workplacebullying.org and sift through the long list of WBI studies, and you will see the ineffectiveness of the bullied target's ability to extricate themselves from the mess. They didn't ask for it, and they can't fix it, and they are not in control of its cessation. So let's get that straight, okay? So therefore, they are not responsible. When we say in the study that their confrontations are ineffective, it is typically because they are in less powerful positions. So they are unable to exert control and get somebody to listen to them, let alone believe them. So it's quite a hurdle, quite a power gradient to cross for a bullied target. So bullied targets shouldn't have to fix the mess they didn't start. Only the employer can fix it. And only by using power from above does a bully actually stop. And they will stop cold in their tracks once they are told by the right person with the appropriate amount of power. They will stop. But until then, they're going to carry on. And when the bully target tries to tell them, implores them to, or requests nicely and politely for them to stop, they will just totally ignore it and blow them off. So given those restrictions and given the following needs, that's how we developed our approach. Number one need, number one goal of our entire process is for targets to make their personal health their top priority. Now, it sounds selfish to targets. It's the darndest thing when people call us to get them to understand they need to put themselves first. They'll put their company first. They have waited way too long for the bully to change or for the employer to fix this problem, and they've gotten sicker from the prolonged exposure to stress while they've been waiting. Stress is going to exacerbate the diseases that can kill you, so you must put your health first. So that's number one. The number two goal of our methodology is actually, and I'm going to tell you this straight up front, is to distract you. Honestly, if you are left to your own devices as a bully target who is in a great state of anxiety, it can be quite debilitating. It can make the person agoraphobic. They'll crawl between the sheets and not want to come out. They're lifeless and listless, and it's a horrible state. And you will constantly play negative scripts about yourself and beat yourself up, and you'll feel guilty for not having done more, and you already feel ashamed because shame, personal shame, is the natural outgrowth of an outcome from the humiliation you've been subjected to. I want you distracted from all of that. So we're going to give you a task, literally a task. Consider it homework or an at-home project. And the project is, of course, going to be very selfish and necessary for you. but we're going to send you to find some numbers and estimate costs associated with the bullying. I want it to be a distraction. The third goal is to compel the employer to be responsible. You are going to, in the third step, take your story, your business case, to the highest level person you can find, not connected to the bully, and you're going to say, well, do you care about profits? If you care about profits, I have a cost-saving opportunity for you. And you need to pitch it as if you were a consultant. And in fact, you are an internal consultant. You're just not from the outside. And you have relevant data they don't have and probably haven't seen ever assembled in one place to demonstrate how to save a lot of money. Of course, the way to save the money is going to be to purge the bully. And you're going to say, do that for business reasons, not because of my health or because of personality conflict. You want that made clear. Now, clearly, if you work for a government agency or a nonprofit organization, profit is not the motive, but balancing the budget is even more critical because your resources are probably more scarce and things are tighter. So saving and shaving costs wherever you can has got to be important to an administrator. So that's the point you want to get across. The problem is we know from the bully's successful ingratiation of that administrator or in the for-profit model, the executive, the higher-level manager, they've been kissing their bottom so much that they have rendered themselves appear to be indispensable. So you have to counter that with they're not only dispensable, they're quite expensive, and retaining them is the wrong decision. Finally, a fourth goal for our approach is I want you to take control back from the bully. Bullying is all about control. Bullies feel this need to compensate for a deficiency, a hole in their soul, if you will, and they will control other people rather than do the work it takes to gain control of their own lives. And so in reaching out to others and exploiting others, bullying happens. So it's all about control. We need you to seize that back. And if our statistics are real and credible and believable, which I think they are, there's a very high probability you're going to lose your job, regardless of what you do. And if that is the case, then at least you can take control of, if not the big picture, you control the nature of your departure. You control how you leave the organization. And basically, you will leave knowing that you were better than they. That's the way it has to be. They were stupid for letting you go. You were great. They are not as good as you, and you were too good for them. So they didn't deserve having your talent. You deserve a better company. You deserve a better employer. So you're regaining control by controlling the nature of your departure. And all of that is the stage setting for why we do the following three-step approach. We say the three-step approach, and it sounds simple, but our model is actually very complicated. The first step takes the longest. First step is to name it. Name it bullying, psychological violence, emotional abuse, an abusive work environment, an abuser. Name the person. Externalize your problem. It is not you, it is they who are the problem. Other people have decided to attack you, to psychologically assault you, for a reason that most likely is based on the fact that you threaten them. And you can read our research about that. But you are a strong person, otherwise independent, but not able to defend yourself when people come at you with this irrational, undeserved, uninvited, crazy-making assault. So the longer you take to name it, the longer you're postponing getting better and your stress is exacerbated. So at some point, you will, quote, stumble upon our website or our books or you'll hear about bullying and you will name this phenomenon. And that day is your aha moment. That is the beginning of the end of the bullying for you because now you're going to be very motivated to do something about it. But it's interesting, until you name it, you probably have been bullied for quite a long time without knowing that it's even a negative event. You might have written it off as just part of the culture or just the way things are or paying your dues or other nonsense like that. There's tremendous healing power in this naming step. So anyway, step one is really all about not knowing and then suddenly knowing that it wasn't you. Step two is going to require you to take time off from work. You need to take paid time off. Do not file a workers' comp claim. HR will want you to file a workers' comp claim. They'll say, well, if you feel that you've been injured, then it's a workers' comp claim. The trouble is, it's very difficult to prove and win a workers' comp claim because your injuries are primarily non-physical. Therefore, they're psychological. And in many, many states, employer groups are passing laws to prevent you from being able to file a workers' comp claim. Yes, that's exactly what they're doing. They're going to stress you to the max, then they're going to deny the workers' comp avenue for redress. I'm talking about in America. In Canada, the most dramatic new law that just came into effect is in British Columbia, and it's actually workers' compensation based for bullying. But that's Canada, not America. We don't do things that way down here. So what do I want you to do in terms of getting paid time off? Try and use short-term disability insurance. It can get you off for 90 days away from the place so you can heal and actually do all this assigned work I'm going to set you up with here and do the project. So go off on disability on your doctor's orders for job stress. File for short-term. You have some time to gather records and do other things in terms of extending your time away from work. And by the way, when you leave, knowing that you're going to file disability, start taking home all your personal effects. Take home your private pictures. Just imagine the creepy bully rifling through your desk, cubicle, box, or work area and finding out private things. So start stripping your company computer of anything private. You shouldn't have had anything there by now anyway. But you want to leave no trace that you were there just in case you might not return, because you might not. These are the things we're going to have you do. You need to check your mental health while you're off during step two, during your health leave. You need to check your mental health with a professional. We do not recommend the employee assistance program. Use your health insurance while you have it, if you have it, to see a counselor, just to verify and validate that you're not crazy and that you are a human being. And if they do not understand trauma or trauma caused by the workplace, they're a bad counselor. See our advice on what kind of counselor or mental health professional you should see. But anyway, check your mental health, check your physical health. Ask your physician to request laboratory results for any indicators that are very sensitive to an inordinate amount of stress. And if you are new to bullying, your blood pressure will show a significant rise. Hypertension is the gateway to all cardiovascular diseases from stress, and it's a really valuable early warning sign. And so you may be starting medications. And in conjunction with a mental health professional, they may suggest the beginning of prescribing antidepressants. But, you know, that's up to you and your healthcare provider. Also want you to research your legal options. I want you to pay for an attorney, rent an attorney. They may give you a free consult, but most likely you'll get better treatment if you request a paid half hour to describe your experiences. So you can't take a half hour to describe your experiences. You have to narrow your story down to 5 minutes or so. And then ask them if you have any legal redress. Are there any state or federal laws that may have been crossed, violated, in your experience? Did the bullying incidents rise to the level of illegality? Oh, they can be quite severe, but as you know from reading our books and watching the videos, severe doesn't mean illegal in the U.S. But they will be listening, I will tell you. The attorneys will be listening very carefully for evidence of discrimination. Do not try and make up discrimination, but if you have gender differences, race differences, age differences, ethnicity differences, religious differences, those are all bases upon which the claims or complaints could be filed to get attention from your employer. But ask an attorney, okay? Don't try and guess. We're not attorneys. We want you to talk to legal professionals. And so you've done that. The other kind of review to do is a review of your company's internal policies. Have any been violated? Chances are very, very good that the violence policy has been violated, because most strict violence policies have in them a clause that says it prohibits verbal abuse. They say they prohibit verbal abuse, but they don't really do a good job of it, without a doubt. But check and see. You may have a bullying policy that is toothless and feckless and worthless. You may have a harassment policy that extends to protect everyone beyond what are called protected status groups. These are all questions for you to explore and get answered while you're home and safe. Do not call HR. These should be probably online. And maybe one of the things you want to take home when you go out on short-term disability leave is the policy and procedure manual, or the little pamphlet you never paid attention to before when you were hired all those years ago. But now you want to dig it out, dust it off, and see if there's anything the employer can be held accountable for. In some states, policies have the force of contract law. And when you talk to the attorney, who clearly should be familiar with employment law in your state, because that's the kind of attorney you want, in fact, you want a plaintiff's attorney, read more at the website about the type of attorney to seek, and you want the advice of that person, they will be aware of state laws, state applicable laws. So you want to look for violations, legal or policy-wise, just to be fully aware of any potential rights that you may or may not have. You need to start looking for the next job. You need to start talking to your network of friends and do everything it takes to get a job. I'm not here to tell you about that in this webinar, but whatever it takes, do. And now the most important task. The project that's going to distract you from misery, debilitating misery, and agoraphobia. I'm going to lead you through how to make a bottom line business case for stopping the bullying. A rationale, an economic, fiscal, financial rationale for your employer to do the right thing. So this is buried inside step two. Let's detail the various ways that bullying actually provides tangible costs for your employer. You know, we always are documenting how an employee, a worker, a bullied worker is harmed. Health harm, loss of social support, and economic harm because so many lose their jobs. But employers suffer too, and that's going to be our point. As consultants, we say that to employers. As an internal consultant, you will say that to your employer. But first, let me discuss who you're going to take this message to. You don't take this wonderful message. It's going to take you a good deal of time to put together. You're going to have to gather data, and then you're going to have to see patterns and summarize things and make a written report and then shorten it and then come up with a one-page summary of that report. You're not going to invest all that time and all that effort to send it to HR, nor will you email this report in. What you're going to do is you're going to make the business case that the bully is too expensive to keep. Take this report to the highest level manager, line manager you can find, that would be somewhat familiar with work that you've done in your unit. In other words, there's an answering responsibility that person's at least two levels above the bully's boss. Okay, this takes us to a very sad point. If you work in a family business, you're pretty much lost once you're bullied. There will be no recourse. You will not pit one family member against another family member. That's just not going to happen. And there aren't going to be multiple levels to go up the ladder. You're going to need to be working in a medium-sized to large company or a government agency to have these multiple levels to which I'm referring. You've got to find somebody disembodied, unrelated to the bully, that's a higher up, who's a line manager responsible for production and budgets, so you can make the point the bully is too expensive to keep. There's a cancer in the trenches that you're going to tell them about, and you're not going to make it a personal argument, you're going to make it an unemotional business argument. Now let's contrast that with an emotional argument. Emotional argument would be one filled with tears, a reliance upon a vivid, long, lengthy, in-depth description of the health harm it's caused you, and you'll be focused on the minutia of each day. At 2:15 p.m., Bob did this to me and that to me. No. It's not that kind of a report. You need to zoom back, helicopter back, up and out, as if you're watching your unit from above and you're catching all the flaws in the bully that are leading to costs. And it's really not about your emotional impact. That's the hard part. That's why you need time to rehearse this story. And the storytelling itself will, over time, be stripped of emotion. You'll be able to tell it more in the third person. You'll be describing what has happened, but it's not happened to you personally. You're looking at it from afar and you're seeing these pairs of people or this mob of assailants, this gang, and you're describing what happens to you as if it's not you. And you know what? You're not going to talk about those behaviors except now with respect to impact on the finances of the organization. And that is the key. So you're going to be telling bad news as it is. You're taking bad news up the ladder. You're violating chain of command. You've got to go high enough to not find the friend and the defender and the executive sponsor of the bully. The executive sponsor is the person we say who props them up. This is the one who's been the target of the bully's ingratiation. It's the person who's behind has been kissed all these years, and they are not going to take well to the message you're bringing. They will get very defensive, and they will fight your message. And they will fire you because you dared to bring this horrible message about someone they wonderfully love who could not be doing the things that you've said have been done. And they will ignore the whole fiscal impact argument. All they'll hear is, my Bob is a bad guy, and they're not going to listen. Okay? And that goes for both genders. I'm just saying Bob. Bob or Bobette. So in order to take this message up the ladder, it's got to be to somebody who's not Bob's defender. So you're going to have to do your homework on that. And hopefully you will hear about an executive or a senior level manager who has not been so pleased with Bob's annex and less prone to support Bob. That's the one you go to. If you find someone who's in charge of the budget or who is a risk manager, risk managers are the ones who are familiar with the pattern of losses. You will speak their language. You're going to talk about losses, but you're going to say these are preventable losses. You bring a negative picture, but you bring a story of hope. You're bringing hope to them that if they were to let Bob go or demote Bob or take Bob out from managing people and strip him of supervisory responsibility, that this Bob could be parked and no longer pose a risk or a liability to the organization. That's the language you want to speak. So to whom you speak it is really, really important. But it will fall on deaf ears at HR. They don't think of money. It'll fall on deaf ears if you go to the bully's boss or someone who is defensive about the bully or who loves the bully. Okay? So you do this for all the reasons I said before, and that's who you take the story to. Okay, now to the nuts and bolts of actually estimating the costs of bullying. All of the following costs should be calculated for the weeks or months or, dare say, years that the bully or the bullies have operated, okay? And that will make your ultimate figure, the total, even more shocking for the higher level executives or managers when they learn about how much this loss has accumulated. And the other point is that you want to estimate the costs as they impacted all affected workers. As we always say, the affected workers include those who are directly targeted for bullying and the witnesses who are vicariously experiencing the negative conduct, the abusive conduct. The number one cost for the business or the government agency or the nonprofit organization is turnover. Even in these tough economic times, turnover still matters to employers because you'll recall that the best and brightest, most talented workers who pose the threat are the ones who are driven out, the ones who are bullied out of their jobs. So what the company is losing, what the employer is losing, is talent. And they're flying out the door, which is entirely preventable, but since they're letting bullying run on unimpeded and with impunity, these costs are adding up. The cost turnovers include the employer's contributions to COBRA insurance for the departed worker, expenses to announce the job opening, headhunter or recruiting firm fees, time spent by all the managers and staff who will meet with all the job candidates, the potential new hires, and group meetings. So while they're all assembled interviewing the next potential person, they're not doing their work, so that's time away. They'll be at the highest level only, of course, hiring bonuses and incentives and moving expenses. Then there's going to be the very hard to calculate lost production costs during this entire process. The person has departed, the job is vacant, the work isn't getting done. There's an interesting intangible associated with that, by the way. All the other coworkers now have that original departed worker's load to share, and there's a great deal of resentment. But that's an intangible and very hard to calculate costs for. So we don't need to worry about that. I'm just talking about the tangible costs. Now, you need to add all of those costs up for all of the people who have been forced out during all of the weeks, months, or years that the one or more bullies have been operating. That's pretty hard to do, huh? Well, here's the good news. And the HR folks have always used a multiple of the departed worker's salary for the replacement cost. The most modest multiplier is 1.5 times that person's salary. Actually, 1.5 times the salary of all those people, because there will be many who have departed because of the bully. The mistreatment can be shown to be the primary cause, okay? 1.5, very low estimate. Truth be told, it is often 3 or 4 times the multiple. So you can get away with 1.5 times the salary or twice the salary. And that doesn't include the full compensation. We're just talking about the salary and not all of the benefits rolled in. If the displaced bullied worker earned a $50,000 salary, the recruit and replacement expenses are $75,000. Add it up for all the people who have been driven out. There's another cost. The second cost is lost opportunity costs. In some professions, the most valuable person is the one responsible for bringing in particular clients, projects, cases, research grants. They are the rainmakers. They are the person who can directly be attributed with bringing in $3, $4 million for a firm because of the clients. And when they're thrown out, the clients go with them. They will be loyal to that individual. So their loss can be just added in. We'll call it lost opportunity costs. If that bully target represented $3 to $4 million in revenue for the company and that person is gone, that's the $3 to $4 million in revenue lost because the bully had to have her or his way. And the company was too afraid to stop the bully and let many of those rainmakers go. Lost opportunity cost. A third cost is absenteeism. And this one's not so terribly hard to calculate. Bully targets make one of two choices. They use all of their pay time off. If the company has sick leave policies, vacations, and holidays that are paid, they'll use all of those and then some. They'll just take time off unpaid. That's one choice. Or the other is they'll actually never take time off for fear that they're going to lose their jobs while they're away. So it's interesting, when people work sick, that is called presenteeism. Not absenteeism. They really should be absent for the sake of the health of all the other workers, but presenteeism is the term used to actually describe sick people coming to work who shouldn't be there. And a second definition of presenteeism, and a probably more modern and better connotation, is that these are the people who are disengaged. A worker who comes to work in body but not in spirit. the old roadies, as the government acronym, or retired on active duty. They show up, they work to specifications, they're very disgruntled, and they're just waiting on responses to the resume, which their resumes for the future jobs, because that's all they're doing with their time. Anyway, you can calculate both absenteeism and presenteeism rates. What you want to do is take the number of days or hours that the targets and all the other affected workers have missed work. Be careful, you want to only choose the times that they've missed work attributable to the bullying, or to deal with the bullying, or to lament the bullying. And so for a target, every day, every hour off will be bullying based. For witnesses, that's not necessarily true, so you might want to cut that absenteeism rate for coworkers in half. But you do want to allow for the fact that they are upset from having witnessed the bullying and are taking mental health days. And you find if they are hourly workers, you will simply take the number of hours absent times their rate. And for salaried exempt workers, you take their annual salary and divide it by 2020. That's the number of work hours in a year. You can figure out their hourly pay rate and estimate from that point forward. Presenteeism is very hard to estimate. There's no doubt about it. It's the antithesis of engaged workers. I call them the three Ds: disgruntled, disgusted, and desperate. You want to try and come up with an approximation of the number of workers who are that and know that they are not really working on the company's behalf or the agency's behalf. They're not accomplishing the mission. They're not delivering products. They're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. And you might want to take a fraction of their hourly pay and consider that a loss. Next category of cost, litigation and settlements. Now, I've said that bullying is legal in the U.S. To the extent that bullying is legal when it does not also simultaneously involve discrimination, as it does in 1 in 5 cases, we've known that since our 2007 national survey. So that doesn't mean people are not going to file lawsuits simply because it's not specifically illegal. They will file lawsuits when they are desperate to have their employer pay attention to them, when they have been treated with indifference and scoffed at and mocked for having filed a complaint or dared to complain. And this is their way to get the employer's attention. And it certainly does, because once a lawsuit is filed, and I say filed, not just threatened, but filed, there needs to be a legal response. And there will either be a commitment of internal legal department staff and personnel, attorneys and counsel in-house, who will mobilize. They're already on salary, but you want to figure out their salary and figure out how much of their time is devoted to the defense, mounting a defense, because that's an expense. It's also much more common that medium and small firms will have not internal departments, but they will have agreements with local law firms, employment law firms, to act as their defense counsel, either on a retainer basis or on an as-needed basis. And when that's true, you can go and find or estimate by making a series of telephone calls to calculate what is the hourly rate for those particular attorneys. They will be quite expensive. They'll be in the $400 per hour and up range and more expensive range. Or they will have retainers of $30,000, $50,000, or $100,000. So it is very, very safe and conservative to estimate that per lawsuit filed by any plaintiff, by any employee plaintiff, that the employer is going to have to invest a minimum of $30,000 to mount a legal defense. So that's one way to do it. And if there are multiple defenses, that'll need to be taken into account. Now, if the lawsuit is actually filed and the process proceeds, then the first step in a lawsuit is actually the calling of the plaintiff for a deposition to try and scare her or him off and convince that person that filing a lawsuit is unwinnable and to quit. So the deposition is very scary and intimidating. The attorneys on the defense side will also be filing motions for summary judgment or dismissal to get the case thrown out of court. And then that's just going to drive the plaintiff crazy. But most of the lawsuits will either be thrown out of court, very, very common. I do not have an estimate of how common it is, but my work as an expert witness seems to indicate that it's a very high rate of cases, good cases, being thrown out. But the other preferred ending point for many, many of the defense attorneys is to merely settle. They tell the employer, in the long run, it is cheaper not to pursue a lawsuit, even if it's winnable, because of the gaps in the current law, make employer cases ultimately winnable. But rather, just settle. Just pay that employee something. Fire them if you must, treat it as a severance, or settle this lawsuit with a cash amount. And so there will be included in the settlement agreements a very specific provision gagging the plaintiff, the bullied worker, from telling about their case and actually ever describing it in detail, with the most thorough gag clauses precluding all details in addition to the amount of the settlement or the severance. So it's really, really important as a plaintiff, as a bullied worker, to get that gag clause modified. Yes, agree to being gagged about the size of the settlement, but not ever losing the ability to tell your story. That seems to be the healthiest outcome for everyone. Anyway, back to calculating the costs, it's going to be very hard for you to find what settlement amounts were because of those gag orders. So you're going to have to play the warm-cold game if you were to call someone who was formerly a litigant and the case was settled. You want to basically say, if I say you settled for $20,000, am I warm or cold? Until you get really hot and kind of zone in on a particular range of what the settlement might be, because they're not allowed to tell you the exact amount. But you can dance around that and try and do your own sleuthing. And you add the costs of the multiple settlements. Because of the years that the bully has operated, there will be multiple settlements over time. And that probably, with turnover, will be the most significant cost. It'll just wow the executive when you present this business case, this figure, in the end. And finally, a category of cost for the employer is the cost of dealing with and resolving workers' compensation claims and disability insurance claims. Now, both of those are types of insurance that employers carry and that will be probably covered for them in terms of prepayment. But here's the interesting thing. When an employee files a workers' comp claim for injury, in this case, primarily a psychological type injury resulting from bullying or abusive conduct, what will happen now in America is that the employer is immediately distrustful and reflexively hires a workers' comp fraud detection company. In other words, they spring into action, hire these shysters who go out and videotape. They will camp out on the street outside the home of the bullied worker and videotape the worker as he or she comes and goes in their house and engages in activity and cuts grass and all these other things, so that they will try and debunk the claim. They will try and undermine the claim. They will try and defame the person and make the claim seem false. So this is especially true in physical injuries. When a person claims a broken leg prevents them from working, or soft tissue damage to the spine has resulted in a painful back and they can't work and lift anymore, the videographers are out there taping them lifting bags of grass and putting it in the trash and moving their trash can to the sidewalk on trash collection day, and then they will use that as evidence to deny the claim. This is partly why we tell people here at WBI to not file workers' compensation claims. The odds are always stacked in favor of the employer. But I say all this to say, when a workers' comp claim is filed or disability insurance, they're going to treat you as if you're lying and manufacturing this, and there will be fraud detection costs associated. You can call these kinds of firms yourself, acting as an employer, and getting their daily rates. But they will stalk the bullied target, and they will do surveillance on their homes for long, long periods of time, for days and weeks and months, to capture video. So I just want to tell you that is probably the last associated cost. So now it all adds up. You've got turnover, opportunities lost, absenteeism, presenteeism, legal defense costs, trial costs, settlements, and workers' comp fraud investigation. Add it all up, and that's the cost of bullying. It proves to a rational person that bullies are too expensive to keep. It shows that they actually impact the bottom line adversely. And it's really, really important that you get a 15-minute meeting with that person that I described before, the highest level person you can, to, quote, share ways to significantly cut costs for the company or agency. Again, you're going to come in as a consultant with these data. Add them up, but also have that grand sum broken into these various categories because it shows thought and preparation. Now, that is how you make a business case. And that is your project while you are home on disability leave. You may not get a positive reception to this message, so be prepared to be searching for that next job. As I told you in step two, at the very beginning, you need to be working on getting that next job simultaneously. However, more and more, as awareness about workplace bullying has grown, thanks in no small part to the work here at WBI, more employers are paying attention to this. More employers are getting a little bit more rational. And their attorneys, their employment law attorneys, counseling them to minimize defense costs, are telling them these are nuisance lawsuits, bullying is preventable, address it, so when you hear about it, act on it. And you are giving them the information to act on and to act wisely. Simultaneously, after you present the fiscal analysis, do say, because they will ask you, what is it you want? You can ask the person be fired, terminated, or moved to a position where they no longer supervise another person. That's well and good. And that's understandable and it seems fair. But that's also unlikely. What you want is safety. You want to be made safe, and you want to be, if you're to be transferred, not to be punitively transferred. By transferring you and letting you retain your income and hold a job at that company, but be out in Siberia, isolated from your friends and colleagues, or being assigned menial work for the same pay, that's not a dignified resolution. So you want safety and dignity and be allowed to do the work that you were originally getting paid to do. And if they are not able to do that for you, you leave with your head held high. You were the one who is better than they. And you need to know that. We're not just rationalizing. You were better. That's why you were bullied. That's why you were targeted for the mistreatment in the first place. So, good luck. It's the best way to reclaim your dignity on the job. We found this over the years. Hopefully you will see this as a much more proactive, positive, long-term for you, the individual, resolution than just running with your tail between your legs to HR and screaming bloody murder only to be ignored. Or the videographers are out there taping them lifting bags of grass and putting it in the trash and moving their trash can to the sidewalk on trash collection day, and then they will use that as evidence to deny the claim. This is partly why we tell people here at WBI to not file workers' compensation claims. The odds are always stacked in favor of the employer. But I say all this to say, when a workers' comp claim is filed or disability insurance, they're going to treat you as if you are lying and manufacturing this, and there will be fraud detection costs associated. You can call these kinds of firms yourself, acting as an employer, and getting their daily rates. But they will stalk the bullied target, and they will do surveillance on their homes for long, long periods of time, for days and weeks and months, to capture video. So I just want to tell you that is probably the last associated cost. So now it all adds up. You've got turnover, opportunities lost, absenteeism, presenteeism, legal defense costs, trial costs, settlements, and workers' comp fraud investigation. Add it all up, and that's the cost of bullying. It proves to a rational person that bullies are too expensive to keep. It shows that they actually impact the bottom line adversely. And it's really, really important that you get a 15-minute meeting with that person that I described before, the highest level person you can, to, quote, share ways to significantly cut costs for the company or agency. Again, you're going to come in as a consultant with these data. Add them up, but also have that grand sum broken into these various categories because it shows thought and preparation. Now, that is how you make a business case. And that is your project while you are home on disability leave. You may not get a positive reception to this message. So be prepared to be searching for that next job. As I told you in step two, at the very beginning, you need to be working on getting that next job simultaneously. However, more and more, as awareness about workplace bullying has grown, thanks in no small part to the work here at WBI, more employers are paying attention to this. More employers are getting a little bit more rational. And their attorneys, their employment law attorneys, counseling them to minimize defense costs, are telling them these are nuisance lawsuits, bullying is preventable, address it, so when you hear about it, act on it. And you are giving them the information to act on and to act wisely. Simultaneously, after you present the fiscal analysis, do say, because they will ask you, what is it you want? You can ask the person be fired, terminated, or move to a position where they no longer supervise another person. That's well and good. And that's understandable and it seems fair. But that's also unlikely. What you want is safety. You want to be made safe and you want to be, if you're to be transferred, not to be punitively transferred. By transferring you and letting you retain your income and hold a job at that company, but be out in Siberia, isolated from your friends and colleagues, or being assigned menial work for the same pay, that's not a dignified resolution. So you want safety and dignity and be allowed to do the work that you were originally getting paid to do. And if they are not able to do that for you, you leave with your head held high. You were the one who is better than they. And you need to know that. We're not just rationalizing. You were better. That's why you were bullied. That's why you were targeted for the mistreatment in the first place. So, good luck. It's the best way to reclaim your dignity on the job. We found this over the years. Hopefully you will see this as a much more proactive, positive, long-term for you, the individual, resolution than just running with your tail between your legs to HR and screaming bloody murder only to be ignored.